So let me just begin with a few words of introduction about the idea of what we are doing here and why we think this contributes to the overall theme of this conference about future and how African futures are made or envisioned. So the topic of this panel addresses a paradox. Development promises a better future, but its outcome may be exactly the opposite, a future in ruins. That is what we suggest to call ghost projects, the visible and oftentimes invisible traces of failed, incomplete, or collapsed developments. The African continent is full of ghost projects, roads that exist only on maps, dams that were never built, development plans that never materialized, and other kinds of unfulfilled promises of development. Ghost projects are thus both real and unreal. They are invisible phenomena, but they leave traces of imagined futures that did not unfold, at least not as planned. Like ghosts, these projects exist in the twilight. They exist in the ambiguous sphere between present realities and imagined futures. In this respect, the study of ghost projects may help us to understand how futures are made, and that's the topic of this conference. Ghost projects have a lot in common with another type of development ruins, the so-called white elephants, but there is a difference, and I think this is something very important to keep in mind. The metaphor of white elephants has an interesting double meaning, which distinguishes it from the image of the ruin. In the history of ancient Siam, that's where the term comes from, formerly or nowadays called Thailand, white elephants had a very ambiguous meaning. On the one hand, they were precious gifts of the king to his nobility, but they were useless for hard work, and they were very expensive in their maintenance. So they constituted a heavy burden for the recipients. In that same sense, projects dubbed as white elephants go along with grandiose promises and exorbitant costs, but they bear no reasonable relation to actual benefits. In other words, white elephants don't work even though they were completed, and ghost projects do some kind of work even though they were not completed. There are a number of ongoing conceptual debates on ruined futures that we consider relevant to this research interest. And I just want to highlight three. First, the focus on the promises of development, or rather its empty promises, draws attention to the implicit teleology of development and modernization. This taken for granted belief has been widely criticized by post-developmental and post-colonial approaches. Focusing on the half-reality of ghost projects allows us to understand these promises in relation to both discursive strategies and material phenomena. Secondly, and related to the first point, we have to address the issue of ruination. The ruins of development do not only include the famous white elephants and the debris of failed projects, but also the less spectacular traces of plans and projects that were not implemented. Just as ghosts haunt the ruins of dilapidated Victorian villas in telenovelas, the ruins of development projects are haunted, both literally and metaphorically, by memories of dead futures. Thirdly, and this relates to the theoretical orientation of the Collaborative Research Center Future Rural Africa in Bonn and Cologne, which is behind this conference, we see ghost projects as arenas of future making. Talking about future making highlights the agency not only of planners, but also of communities and people living within the political arena created around abandoned projects. An arena may be understood as a meeting place of competing actors in their struggle to gain control over a particular transformative process. The open-endedness of unfinished ghost projects also opens the door for contentious practices of future-making that challenge the status quo of infrastructure master plans. In this panel, we want to address the following questions. So I just want to highlight a few out of many questions that we will discuss in the coming hours. How do imagined futures influence contemporary practice of future making, even if the original plans are not implemented? How do people living around ghost projects appropriate its ruins for their own purposes? To what extent do these ruins determine or influence practices of future making? How are practices of future making related to the memories of the past that haunt unfinished ghost projects? And finally, how are such failed or unrealized plans locally appropriated and filled with life? So again, we are discussing a paradox. We are talking about ghost phenomena that are very difficult to grasp, because they're visible and at the same time invisible. Okay, so now I would like to invite the first speaker, Theo Aalders, on the invisible horror of infrastructure projects and the monsters. All right.
When I was doing research in 2018, I happened to do that on a thing that didn't exist, on the Lapset corridor, which was difficult because it's not easy researching something that doesn't exist. So as a researcher, of course, I just asked the people who I was encountering living alongside that corridor, like, what is the Lapset? What is this thing that doesn't exist? And they gave the following answers.
First started hearing of the Lapset project, it's coming. But up to date, we are still, I don't know if it's a ghost, white ghost or a white elephant project.
Maybe it's an animal.
As myself, I don't know really what Lapset is.
You don't know?
I don't know. So I don't have any idea of Lapset, but I heard there's something animal called Lapset. But I don't have any information because I was not part of it when they shared information.
Yeah. What do you mean the animal called Lapset?
Because it will come and it might swallow me with my what I have in the ground.
Or a monster.
It's actually a monster. Mm. A monster that is waiting to be taken away.
So this is the time for monsters, obviously. Ghost projects and the invisible horror of infrastructure. This is, I should add, a rather conceptual point that I'm trying to make, just a suggestion to think through the way that people engage with invisible infrastructures, non-existing projects, through the lens of horror. In particular, I'm looking not only at the Lapset corridor, but also at a more recent project. You can see here, the UK Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, says he will be a Santa, not a Scrooge, with new budget statement. And the budget is for this on the top right. You can see the High Grand Falls Dam in Kenya. Mm. And of course, everyone knows, like, Scrooge was haunted by his own kind of ghost from the past in this case. And I should add, though, at this point that I am not suggesting that infrastructure is inherently horror. What I'm looking at, or the question that I'm asking, is why infrastructure becomes a horror story to some and a Christmas story, like in this case, to others. You can see here those, like, very bright promises of what the High Grand Falls might look like in future. On the top, in the bottom right, you see the vision of the Lapset corridor from the authority website, a premier institution delivering a vibrant lapset corridor with world-class transformative and game-changing infrastructure, and then, of course, a famous African African tiger next to it. Because that makes sense. The question then is, like, how do these very promising promises of tigers and Santas, how do they turn bitter for some people? And when I'm approaching a question, the first thing I do is I consult Marx. And interestingly, Marx himself uses a lot of Gothic metaphors in his writing. The most famous one, of course, the specter haunting Europe. This, by the way, is a specter that is haunting the present, not from the past, as most specters do, but from the future. And then Derrida's kind of take on those specters of Marx. He works also a lot with Shakespeare's Hamlet and the famous line, "The time is out of joint." It is about temporality. So ghosts are haunting the present from both the past and the future. That is, I think, one of the main things that I get out of that literature. And then also it branches off. Gramsci famously said that when the old world is dying and the new world struggles to be born, in this interregnum a great variety of morbid symptoms appear, and then Slavoj Žižek comes along, and in his way, he's like translates that very differently, but I think more concisely, as now is the time of monsters. And I find that translation very peculiar and very interesting. It is. I would like to have that confidence, just like translating a sentence, like making it something entirely different. But I think we can still learn a lot from that, that monsters appear in an interregnum defined by the revelation of something new. Something new is coming about, and this is the time of monsters. This is what I'm looking at right now. Interestingly, there's also a lot of talk of horror tropes in, more particularly, the literature on infrastructure, like infrastructure studies. And of course, first comes to mind Ashley Carse's and David Knaes, work on unbuilt and unfinished infrastructure, and they develop a typology. And one of the types that they are developing is about zombies, zombie infrastructure. Infrastructures linger between the dissipation and reemergence of the social, political, and economic networks that give them life. So we see Gramsci's interregnum also reappearing here. And then secondly, good friend Gedis Lesoutis talking about the politics of disavowal, and the context of the biopolitics of infrastructure, the necropolitics of infrastructure, the way that they are defined by life-giving but also death-making processes. And he argues that many infrastructure projects that are not finished, especially now here in Kenya, are coined by a certain disavowal of subjects, an abandonment, so that people are abandoned to endure in the margins of mega projects. And then lastly, in order to bring back the monster, the late Bruno Latour has been writing about Frankensteins, that in the way that we have created monsters in the technology, in the infrastructural technology, I might add, that we've created and we've failed to care for them. And now, famously, Frankenstein created his monster not by stitching together some corpses, but then by abandoning that new person that he created and thus making him a monster only in the month after his actual creation by abandoning him. And so here we have a very rare confluence of different things, which is, on the one hand, we have local imaginaries that use tropes such as monsters and ghosts and animals that come to swallow you whole. On the other hand, you have Marxist theory, Gothic Marxism, that uses the same tropes. And then again, we have critical infrastructure studies, again, using the same tropes of horror. And that alone made me curious, like, how come that those very, very different fields not even fish, just like people, all come and gravitate towards that kind of metaphor or description. And maybe it's not even a metaphor, we'll find out. I think it might make sense to dive a little bit into what makes horror horrific, into the genre of horror, so to say. And there are some tropes. One trope is the one that was mentioned in the introduction, the abandoned Victorian villa. We have this theme of abandonment and ghosts living in abandoned places. And in the similar vein, Frankenstein also being, or the Frankenstein's monster being abandoned by his creator. And that's interesting, also becoming synonymous. The monster then, of course, like we say, Frankenstein meaning the monster, and of course that is also interesting. Secondly, we have memories and anticipation. Famously, Alfred Hitchcock said that there is no terror or horror, for the purpose of this talk, in the bang, only in the anticipation of it, only waiting for something to happen. This is where horror happens, right? In waiting for a project to be finalized or to even be started with all the positive or maybe negative connotations that this might entail. And I think one of the best theorists of this kind of anticipation of the bang is Jordan Peele, famous horror movie maker. And he had the following to say about how his horror movies work. I don't know, who has seen Jordan Peele horror movies? Raise your hands. Two people, okay, that is not the right audience for this clip. Anyways, here it is anyways.
And it's like this idea of like if a black person was the protagonist of a horror movie, it would be a very short movie. Mm-hmm. And I'm just, at this point, I'm just going to get a prior laugh. So that's weird. But yeah, the bit was, you know, the black family comes into a haunted house. I think it's Eddie Murphy. Yeah. Comes in the haunted house, and now, oh, these drapes are great. And they get out. Too bad we can't stay, baby. It's not my bit.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, it was like, what happens when you let a black person be the protagonist in a horror movie, and it turns out you have a movie that has a protagonist that is aware that horror is going down.
Night of the Living Dead, there's only one black guy in Night of the Living Dead.
Yeah,
it's not black horror.
Yeah, no, he's the man. He's the
reasonable character in it. He's the reasonable character in it.
He's the guy, in Night of the Living Dead, he is the guy who is ready to fight zombies because he's been fighting white people off his whole life.
This is funny, but it's also very profound. Because what makes horror work is that people are oblivious that they are in a horror movie. They don't hear the eerie music in the background, right? But and Jordan Peele is saying, like, no, this would not work for black horror movie because people have experienced these horrors their entire life. They wouldn't be oblivious to it, right? And so what I think can be drawn from this is the idea of memories of the future, meaning that I anticipate a certain future to happen based on the memories I have. In the context of the project that we are talking about, what are those memories? And here's another video from called Project Oil Kenya. And they make it very explicit what they are trying to remember with their projects.
And just as the transport sector, the old railway of over 100 years ago, opened up Kenya's only development corridor that has been the anchor of Kenya's development, the new oil and gas industry represents our opportunity to open up northern Kenya for expansion and development.
The parallel here, I think, is quite stunning. There's a direct comparison between an old colonial project, a railway project, and now a new pipeline that's being built, and essentially said, we're going to do the exact same thing. And by the way, it's going to be amazing, and so we have to mention the word development three times in one sentence. The problem is that people don't remember that the same way, that period of time. So here's a comic that I did a collaboration with one of the people who are living alongside the Lapset corridor, and he's actually a poet. So he wrote a poem about the Lapset corridor, and one stanza it reads like this. My great-grandfather suffered greatly. Is it my turn to face and test the worst? I wonder, a tricky treasure. He calls Lapset a tricky treasure. And so the memories of the past inform his anticipations of what's going to come. He knows his grandfather suffered greatly from past colonial projects, so now he's expecting something similar to happen to himself. He lives in a horror movie. On the left, they're living in a sci-fi movie, right? Lastly, we have the process of revelations in horror movie. This is a third trope that happens, that it is not about the monster being completely hidden the entire movie. It's not about the monster being visible the entire movie. It is about the slow reveal of the monstrousness in the movie. Alien, I think, is a great example for that. I think the alien has a screen time of 4 minutes in the entire movie. You see glimpses, shadows, something of it. It is like a slow process of revelation of what is going to happen. And with that comes a lot of uncertainty. The uncertainty that I think is encapsulated in the sentence, a tricky treasure. You don't know what's in it. And slowly it's being opened. And this is where the horror lies in unfinished infrastructure projects. Of course, all of these things are related to one another. So the abandonment relates to the memories, of course, like the memories of the past, the ruins, the abandoned ruins of the past relate to the memories. The Frankenstein's monster, for example, the abandoned monster, and also revealed slowly throughout the entire book by Mary Shelley. And lastly, the uncertainty also relates to the anticipation of something that is going to happen, might happen, but you don't know when and where and why. And this uncertainty, by the way, I think is a key factor in understanding the monstrousness of unfinished projects. Here I've just highlighted all the times that people mentioning in the same sentence the ghosts, the monstrous animals, and the monsters that are going to eat them or swallow them or take them somewhere, they're saying, it is coming, being revealed, but I don't know if it is a ghost or a white elephant project. I don't know. I don't have any idea. I don't have any information. See, Jui, Nita Pelekwa Wapi, like, where is it going to take me? I don't know, right? There's this idea of uncertainty that is, I think, is very central. So trying to bring this all together, here's a framework that I am suggesting very quickly. So we have certain horror tropes like the idea of abandonment and ruination, memories and anticipation, and slow revelation. And that mirrors local imaginaries of I was not part of it when they shared the information, of I was abandoned by the project leaders, of memories. My grandfather suffered greatly. It is my turn now to face the worst, and anticipations. And lastly, of revelations, a monster is waiting. Sijui Nita Pelekwa Wapi. It is waiting, it is slowly revealed what it's up to. And that I think also has parallels to infrastructure theory that I've mentioned before. I'm running out of time right now, so I think I'll just let this stand for now, 1 minute left. In the very end, I just want to talk about how horrors work in both directions. So this is like a new project that I've been doing with two colleagues of mine, Kibuka Falls at Tharakanithi, and there's a legend that there are people living down there, down under the water. And the dam is going to be built somewhere here, but it actually doesn't exist yet. It's only being planned right now. And there's a story that I've heard that during colonial times, like a gentleman came, a British gentleman, and he wanted to build a bridge somewhere across the waters. But then, unfortunately, while he was scouting, his wife fell into the water, or rather, as the local legend goes, was taken by the people living there. And then when they tried to find her, they found her sitting there under the waves, weaving a basket, which is like a traditional thing that people do in this area. And in horror, the gentleman left because he saw that his wife actually adopted the way of the people living around this area. So the horror can go in both ways, right? The producing of uncertainty of infrastructure projects can also be the horror of the planners. And with that, I'm going to leave you. Thank you so much for your attention.
So my name is Jonathan Gez. I'm based at the Ishkete at University in Lisbon. And I'm very excited to that this panel takes place here today. And 2 days ago, there was another one that very much kind of links well with the same kind of ideas of, about past futures. So there seems to be a lot of interest in where this line of research is going. So about 3-4 years ago, I think I also kind of caught this direction, saw that something is emerging, and started thinking about an ERC, European Research Council project on what I call, and I'm not the only one using that term, the afterlives of development interventions, okay? So this is the language that we're using, the living dead, the zombies, the afterlife. I think, by the way, I would say this in brackets, that I already heard that in the kind of in the opening words, right? I mean, there's a question of framing. There's a framing of kind of positivity, of opportunity, of kind of a local agency. And then there's the framing of horror and all of it. So, you know, of ghosts, right? Of destruction, of ruins. And it's always a question how. So I kind of am happy with afterlives. With afterlives, because it's somehow it evokes something perhaps also a bit spiritual. But essentially, the idea is that we're looking beyond the formal time frames of a development interventions, right? A funding cycle, or in many respects, its formal reach, its formal objectives. And I want to tell you about this project and. If time permits, maybe share some directions of where we're going with this. Everything is still very much tentative. We're trying to develop a set of methods that go along with our approach to the question, right? So we call this AfDev Lives, the Afterlives Development Interventions. We look at Eastern Africa, so again, Kenya, as well as Tanzania and Mozambique. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. AF stands for Africa, could be after, dev, develop, international development. I mean, we can spend the whole day discussing what kind of should be put in this basket. We tend to approach the concept of development in a pretty inclusive way, and as a general rule, we embrace a kind of a bottom-up approach to the terminologies. So really, development is what it is, what counts as development for the people with whom we engage, which could be a lot of things, including things that we in this room might not normally consider as development, strictly speaking. And lives is really our emphasis, right? The kind of lived experiences of people on the ground, kind of the reappropriations of projects, especially after they kind of run their course. And this whole combined title evokes this cadence of afterlives, which is conjugated in the plural because, well, especially after the formal scripts and collapse, you would often have a kind of multiplicity of possibilities, kind of a, sometimes, I mean, it's a bit romantic to say democratization of ruins, but certainly many avenues that open up once you have this recession of the kind of the imposed formal scripts of how it should be, okay? Oops, other direction. So under PI, we have three brilliant PhDs. one of them is with us today, and two brilliant postdocs. One of them is here with us today, hiding her head in shame. But it's really, I mean, it's a group effort, and I think we try to make this as collaborative as possible, both within the team and with the communities that we will work with. And also, I would say a lot of it has to do with collaborations directly with universities and researchers in East Africa. It's a very central element in what we do. Happy to talk about it some more later on. So where is this coming from? A word about the background of this project. So a couple of years ago, as a side project, okay, my background is more in anthropology of religion, really. As a side project a few years ago, I joined a colleague of mine who had a research by National Science Foundation project looking at Israel-led, I'm originally from Israel, Israel-led the agricultural cooperatives that were implemented in a couple of countries in sub-Saharan Africa in the 1960s and 1970s. If you know the kibbutz or the moshav, these kind of agricultural cooperatives, and I visited some in Zambia and Tanzania. There were some in other places as well, and wherever I went, there was this question, right, that you always heard, that we heard, when are you coming back? And of course, it's a question that makes me as a researcher very uncomfortable, right? I don't want to kind of create false hopes, and also I don't want to be confused with a development worker, because in my mind, I am not. And there's a lot of literature that actually kind of blurs that kind of makes, I think, a good argument why we are more like development workers than we actually think of ourselves, right? But I think mainly I was kind of struck by a paradigm of work that creates a very kind of problematic, I think, alienation between the people and the places where they are. You know, we're very much focused on oral interviews. We're very much focused on a kind of narratives of history. And I felt that there must be another way or other ways in which we can really try to grasp what it means to be kind of embedded, to be kind of embodied in a place where you kind of your landscape is strewn with those interventions, and this is something that is part of your existence over many decades, right? So this short question, which we heard a lot, symbolized a lot of things, but it also really, I think, symbolized a very kind of narrow frame of how the projects are engaged with, right? Through a very kind of particular prism of utility, of investment, of you know, of success and failure. And I felt that this is missing a lot of what is how it actually is for the people to be living and working to coexist alongside these projects over time. And I started reading about this, and you know, there's a lot of literature on that. Robert Chambers, one of the pioneers of participatory approaches to development, also kind of encouraged me through his question, what is it that makes development studies academics and researchers, and one might add also development practitioners, because there's a lot of kind of flow from one to the other, quite conservative in terms of approaches and methods. He says, so conservative. I thought this is a challenge, right? You know, how do we try to, how would we try to really capture kind of the experiences of places where development was implemented without still maintaining the kind of the prism, the kind of the assumptions, the language, the perspective of the development projects themselves, right, including the prism of success and failure. And essentially, the way that kind of the way that I articulated to myself, how do we move beyond thinking about development as happening in sites? So sites, you think about construction sites, you think about, you know, something that is prospective, right, towards an objective, to seeing projects as something that, you know, happens to happen in places where people live, where people have a very intimate connection to their environment. And how do we capture that? So, I mean, I think this is kind of something that is hovering over this double panel, right? The prospective idea of development. Development is progress. And then if we think about ruination and nostalgia, right, this backwards idea, right, this idea again of past futures and, you know, and, but what we really are interested in, and, well, I don't know how to, yeah, but anyway, the central one, right, so we are really interested in the present experience, what it is to be kind of in this intermittent kind of space, right, where you have those projections of ideas of a certain future, oftentimes kind of imposed or external to the community, and then you have those kind of experiences of these ideas not necessarily coming to fruition, but in between you've got these people who kind of live, make sense of all these interventions over time. It's really important to emphasize that we're not looking at projects sensu stricto, right? We're not interested in how projects are successful or unsuccessful in and of themselves. I want to show you an example how you know, how our approach tries to be a little different here. So this is the project office of one of the agricultural cooperatives that I was looking at in northwestern Tanzania in 2015. And you know, this is one project, but if you look at the village, actually, you know, you broaden your perspective, you see that actually this was just one of many, many, many interventions that kind of pass through that area over time. And this is quite a small village, you know, kind of so-called peripheral area, and yet within it, it kind of holds a great multiplicity. So we're trying to be a lot more interested in kind of the story of a place and this kind of multi-layering of different interventions over time and the way that people make sense, combine all those experiences. The research question, right, for our project is how are the representational and material remains of past development interventions in Eastern Africa experienced, employed, and reappropriated by local actors over time, and how does such imminence of the multi-layered past come to bear on local life worlds? Okay, and here we get our cue, or at least when I was kind of began thinking about this, I was very inspired by the work of Tim Ingold, even though he doesn't talk about development as such, but I feel that he is very much going in that direction of trying to hold the human experience as something that is completely kind of inseparable from our surrounding, from the context that you know, everything kind of operates at the same time. It's not the human agent that just operates on the you know, on the material world, on the environment, in the same way that it is not only the designer, the development designer, who operates on the kind of right the kind of the local context where they kind of implement their ideas. What does it mean to try to develop a dwelling perspective that kind of takes into consideration how people are in place, you know, and which other methods should be used so that we don't end up with these kind of questions of, you know, when are you coming back? These kind of very reductionist ideas of being thought of as kind of representatives of development interventions themselves, right? So the way that this works, we have three work packages that are focused more on field work. We haven't actually started our field work. We are leaving, this summer we're gonna do our first round of field work the end of this month. And there are various methods that are really just a starting point to start thinking about that deep connection between people and places over time. So we have movement, image, and storytelling. So for example, for each one, there's again, this is really just a starting point. Something that I really believe in is the practice of walking interviews. So again, this feeling of kind of grounded, the close connection between people and the environment and how the environment affects our interaction in real time, right? So it's not just a kind of a discursive reflection, intellectual kind of distancing, but it's everything is in place. Worked with graphics, worked with, it was, had some really nice examples now, what can be done with that. And also focusing on objects and what they mean and object biographies. At the same time, there's kind of a second layer of developing participatory methods together with local actors, with the idea that this, the, kind of the third stage would be to then also think together with locals, what does that, how would you see that translated into a kind of an, a voice, right? What would you like to say and to whom and with the use of which tools, right? So we are, we can develop collaboratively certain outputs that then in all sorts of ways could then perhaps kind of transferred back perhaps to the institutional heirs of those organizations that operated in those localities. And yeah, so these are some of the ideas, selection of case studies. Okay, so do I have two more minutes to?
Two, yes.
Okay, so very quickly, because I think maybe this was a little too abstract. So this summer, we are going, actually at the end of this month, we're going to Western Kenya, a place called Kakamega. And I want to give you just a little example of how we might approach this, right? One of many case studies that we will be developing. So in the 1980s and 1990s, there was a huge water infrastructure project financed by the government of Finland through a number of consultancies. In this area, you can see in red, in Western Kenya, a very densely populated area, and it was very, very ambitious. You see the title here, Water for a Million. The idea was we will provide fresh drinking water, shallow wells, boreholes and such, to over a million people. Today there are many more living there in the area. The project ran for about 15 years. I'm not getting into the details. Actually, some of the wells are still operating today. And so what do we do with something like that? Now, this is an imperfect example because here I'm starting from the project rather than from the locality, right? So, but it's still, I think, a good illustration. We also have other examples where we kind of start more from the place. So what do we do in something like that? First of all, we visited the sites. This was already last year. Sorry about that, Elisabeth. So you know, you visited the site. We talked to people. Kind of very preliminary kind of discussion. Here on the bottom, you can see this is the estate where the Finnish development workers were living. There's the swimming pool next to it. There's the sauna as well that they have built, right? All those kind of remains that are still very much with us and what has become of them through the years. Secondly, we went to the archives, both in Finland and in Kenya, to look at the material. We found, you know, thousands of documents in Finnish and in English mainly. Thirdly, we went to Finland and we interviewed retired, mainly retired engineers who worked in that project in the 80s and 90s. It was very moving. Some of them invited us to their homes and, you know, lots of family photos from that time, or photos of, you know, friends from the project and memories and pastime and all those things. And now, this is where we're going now. Oops, I don't know what happened there. So at the end of this month, we're going to have a large collaborative fieldwork and training exercise there in Kakamega. I'm finishing in a minute. And then the idea is that, and this is something I'm very excited about, together with more university in May in Eldoret in Western Kenya, we're going to kind of bring in those different voices. We're going to invite the Finnish development workers and local actors and also, and of course, our own researchers, and we're going to have a conversation, right? Because I don't know what that would bring, but I think it's really, really essential to have this conversation 30 years or so after the project has ended. You know, what are the expectations, what are the obligations, what are responsibilities, what else can be done or shouldn't be done. And of course also on the Finnish side, there's a lot of personal memories, a lot of personal experiences related to this. And then we develop a couple of individual case studies, and then we want to co-create relevant material together with local communities. So this is kind of the order of how we might work. But of course, things are open. We only started 8 months ago. We're going to run for 5 years until 2027. Happy to be part of a conversation, wider conversation, and we can talk some more afterwards. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. I'm Ronald, and this talk today is based on work in progress. We have started this project back in January, so we have done some fieldwork already. We have like 5 weeks into the fieldwork to this project. Our project explores the stalled or cancelled land-based agricultural investments, and we're trying to look at how this impacts on access to land and livelihoods among the smallholder farmers and herders in Tanzania. And our work is based on two main things. One is the slow or partial progress in terms of implementation of these projects in Africa. For example, some literature shows that about only 0.3% of the land that has been allocated for these projects is actually being utilized. So about 22 million hectares of land have been allocated to land-based investments, especially agricultural investments in Africa, but only 0.3% of that is being utilized. And also, much of the research focus at the moment is mainly on the project start. Most research is focusing when projects are starting, and much is really done in regards to what happens when these projects are actually in progression, and most importantly, what happens when these projects are actually stalled or they fail. So that's what we are trying to address in this particular project. So our objectives are twofold. One is to assess the effects of closed or stalled land deals and how that affects access, how smallholders and herders are represented, recognized in these processes, but also to look into how such processes actually affect smallholders, farmers and herders in terms of livelihoods. So it's our work, our project is a multiple case studies approach. We are currently following upon four projects, the four on top. Three of those are actually being followed by myself and my colleague, who is based at the Swedish University of Agricultural Sciences, whom we are collaborating with. And the fourth one, Sun Biofuels, is actually being followed by one of our master students who is attached to the project. We are also thinking of following upon other projects, so this is still tentative. Three of them. One is run by a state parastatal, a very ambitious sugar project, and the other ones are on jatropha and rice. So this is a map of Tanzania. For those of you who are not aware, it's just to give you a spatial sense of it. So the two projects are on the western part of the country in the region called Kigoma. Actually, it borders Burundi and the Democratic Republic of Congo. And the two projects were actually aimed for oil palm in Kigoma. Kigoma is suitable for oil palm. But both of them have actually, they stalled and then they have eventually failed. And the other projects that we are, investments that we are following is Eco Energy, in Bagamoyo Sugar Limited. as well as sand biofuel, it's not clearly seen. So the two under the red symbols are the ones that we are following up on. The one under green is actually operational. I'll talk a bit more about it in a moment. And the remainder, further south, the ones that we are planning to follow up on probably later during the project. So what we are basically looking at are projects that are not being implemented. So the land has been allocated for the projects, but nothing really happened. So the land is technically lying in limbo. It's not really very clear what is actually going to happen. There are no investors. There are people living in the land, but they're not actually certain as regards to what is going to happen tomorrow, the next month, or the next year. So what we are already trying to look into is what actually entails this land in limbo. What is happening there? And in doing so, we are following upon what is happening in the areas that were allocated for these projects. And in case of Bagamoyo, which is on the eastern part of the country along the coast, we are following upon two projects, which is the Bagamoyo Eco Energy, the failed one. This is a project that was actually initiated in 2006 when the MOU was signed. And initially, it was a bioethanol project. So the plan was to plant sugarcane to produce ethanol. And it was actually a Swedish initiative. It was a project from Sweden. And so the initial support for the project was actually coming from the Swedish International Development Agency, SIDA. And at the time, they had promised to fund the initiative with a tune of 16 million USD. But actually, until the project stalled, they had already disbursed about 5 million US dollars. So since then, actually, things started going astray, and funding was not actually coming by. And the investments, actually, the project had already made some evaluation and assessment to compensate the people who were on the land with plans to evict them. But because there was no money to compensate them, actually, the people were still there. And they are still there as we are speaking. Some of them are actually still waiting for the compensation to be paid so that they can vacate the area. So fast forward, 2016, the fifth government comes into power under the leadership of the late Magufuli, President Magufuli, and who had some ambitious political projects, including the industrialization, which is state-led. So he was really pushing for state-led parastatals also get into active sectors of economy or production. And alongside that, it was actually to attract more investors who were interested to put up factories and industries. And one of the initiatives was actually to reallocate land, what was being used, that was not being used. Land that had previously been allocated for investment but was laying idle and was not being used. So the Bagamoyo Eco Energy fell victim to that initiative. So the land was actually taken back by orders by the president. This is one of the few pieces of land that was taken back by the state in Tanzania. So in essence, actually, Bagamoyo Eco Energy lost the rights to the title of that land. And after that, a lawsuit ensued, and actually they sued the government at a Washington court, International Court for Settlement of Investment Disputes. And so the case has been running, and just last year, I think it was November or December, actually, the case was concluded, and the former investor was actually won the case. So the government of Tanzania was supposed to pay to compensate the investor for the losses that have been incurred and the losses that were missed? Should they have proceeded with the investment? So what is going on at the moment is the payment. So payment is ongoing. We are not sure how much has been paid yet or how much was supposed to be paid to the investor. Probably we'll be able to find out later as we continue. So that was part one of the Bagamoyo saga. The second part is with regards to Bagamoyo Sugar Limited. Now this is what happened after the land was reclaimed by the government. So half of it, 10,000 hectares, were actually allocated to a local business person slash investor called Bagresa. He's a Tanzanian of Asian origin, but born and raised in Tanzania. Just to give you a bit of a background, in 2016, just a few months after Magufuli had gotten into power, there was a big crisis, sugar crisis in the country, and which brought up a lot of hot discussion in the public as regards to what the government is actually trying to do to address the sugar scarcity, because it was a recurring problem. So out of that, actually, the push was for the government to come up with drastic measures to address once and for all the problem of sugar scarcity in the country. And this is how Bagamoyo Sugar came into being. Actually, in a public political rally, the president actually offered to give land to any investors who was willing and ready to invest and produce sugar. So, and Bagresa was one of the guys who were ready to do that. So that's how they ended up getting the land that was previously under the eco energy investments. So half of that land was given to Bagresa, and the factory is already operational. They have already, sugar is already on the shelves in the supermarkets, and I think later this year in July, they are going to start with the second harvest. And the production is actually done within just 1,600 hectares of the land that has been allocated. So about 8,000 or so of land is still unutilized, probably potential for further expansion in the future. The factory employs about 1,200 workers. 6 of them are actually seasonal, and mostly harvesters who come on seasonal basis to harvest and then go back. And these are most, on average, they are paid 6,500 Tanzanian shillings, which is roughly $2 a day. Anyway, so what we are left with is the 10,000 hectares from the 20 that were previously under the Bagamoyo Eco Energy. So this is the land that is actually in limbo at the moment. And there are few people who are living in that land. Some of them are the ones who were relocated from the 10,000 hectares that were given to the sugar factory, which is running now. And some of them are the ones who were living on the land, even from the times of the eco energy investment. But on top of that, we are already seeing an influx of people coming to acquire land in those 10 hectares. And the drive is mainly because land is cheap there, because this is general land, and the people who are living there, they know it's general land, and they can sell it cheaply. So when we are doing field work, actually, the language that is being used is not to buy or sell, it's just to compensate people for what they have done on the land, to keep it clear, to keep the bush from growing. So what we are already seeing is that the people who come to buy land or acquire land there of two types. One are land speculators, because Bagamoyo is located about 55, 65 kilometers from Dar es Salaam. So this is where the city is expanding to. So there's a lot of land speculation in that part of the country. But two, so these are the ones who are aware that the land is general land, but they are just speculating. Probably they might be compensated should another investor come. So it's a gamble. But the second group are people who are not really aware of what is going on. They think this is village land, and they can acquire land at a very cheap price. We also have a group of people who were living there previously, but they have left the area while keeping their plots. And most of these are the ones who were actually expecting to be compensated by the previous investor, the Bagamoyo Eco Energy. So that was the first part, which is on Bagamoyo, the eastern part of the country. Now let's go back to the western part, near the border with Burundi and Congo, DR. There we have two investors whom we are following upon. One is Felisa Limited. This is a company that was planning to, as I said, to invest in oil palm. So they were given land in one of the districts in Kigoma called Uvinza, to the tune of 4,000 hectares. And it was a joint venture between a Tanzanian investor and a Belgian. And they had acquired loan from one of the state parastatals called National Social Security Fund. It had agreed to fund them in the initiative. So they also gave them the first installment, which they used to clear the land and actually establish a nursery, oil palm nursery. But unfortunately, the second installment was not disbursed because of some of the things that I'm going to talk about. In 2016, when Magufuli came into power, that was about the time that the investment, Felisa, was actually processing or negotiating with the NSSF for the second installment. But the coming into power by Magufuli actually changed everything because the ambitious industrialization drive actually changed all the focus by state parastatals. And the NSSS, for example, they got into industrialization themselves. Actually, the Mkulazi that I mentioned was their initiative. So they abandoned other initiatives that they were into. And this actually affected Felisa in terms of accessing the second installment. So the project actually was stalled and failed. The other investment is called Agrisol, but these, they were given land, but they never showed up. So there's not much talk about them. So what are the potential analytical strands? One is the role of state in installing or closure of investments, conflicts between the state and investors. We also see the role of sugar importers or sugar barons who are in ties with some elites within the ruling party, CCM. These investors, sugar importers actually get a lot of profits from these deals because they are exempted from tax. So it's a lot more profitable for sugar barons to invest sugar rather than invest in factories for sugar manufacturing. So this has kind of affected sugar-based investments in the country. Land claims between government agencies, for example, where Econ23 was is actually, the land is bordered by a national park. So the national park is actually claiming part of the land to that. So these are some of the things that affect investors. I've already talked about Magufuli. I've already said about this. So quickly to wind up, what does the limbo do? One is changes in access to land and land use. The land has become cheaper. The land in limbo is becoming cheaper to some people so they can easily get it and use it, though with a lot of uncertainty. There's no developments because people have been cautioned by the government not to make any permanent developments on the land in terms of facilities or permanent crops. There's no service provisioning in terms of public services like water, health, schools, and things like that. And the land is not actually well utilized in economic sense. Yeah, we're also seeing a lot of issues in relation to land scarcity in the villages that are bordering the areas, because some of the land that was given to the investors were actually chopped out of the village land, so land is becoming scarcer. The population is booming. We are seeing a lot of in-migration. People are trying to go into these areas because they're in limbo, easy to access. For instance, the Sukuma agropastoral is coming from the Lake Victoria Basin, the Lake Victoria region in the northern part, northwestern part of the country. There also likelihood, there's also a likelihood of an increase in conflicts, in conflicts at different scales between local communities, farmers and herders, between local communities and the government, which is actually controlling the land, and between the government and investors, between local communities and investors. So finally, what does the future look like? Three main things that we are thinking that are likely to happen. One is the increasing uncertainty in terms of land tenure. And now with the new government, which is pro-investments, we are likely to see the emergence of this cycle again. We are likely to see a lot of investors coming, getting land, and probably some of them not being able to do anything with that. So with a lot of implications like food security, poverty levels, urban migration due to landlessness. And lastly, more conflicts are likely to arise from that. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
My name is Christopher Schulz. I'm a lecturer in sustainable development at the University of St. Andrews in Scotland in the UK. And I will not talk about a particular ghost project, but rather a policy response to ghost projects or also white elephants. To those of you who were here in the morning, you heard the distinction in the definition between the two. So this project or this presentation emerges out of a project I did before joining St. Andrews last year. So that was at the Department of Geography in Cambridge, where I was working with Bill Adams on the history of large dams globally, with a specific focus on the work of the World Commission on Dams, which was active around 20 years ago, trying to understand what was dam policy like at the time, why was this commission established, and have we learned anything? Because I think we see a lot of similar patterns with the problems with large dams, how people respond to them in Africa, but also in other parts of the world. And any of you who are working with large dams, you will have probably seen this map published now 8 years ago, showing in blue where dams are currently being built, or at the time, 2015. So China is building a lot of dams. But we also see in red planned dams, so lots of them in South America, but clearly Africa is also a continent with a lot of plans for dams, maybe a lot of ghost projects, maybe they will actually materialize eventually, but certainly Africa is one of the important places for large dam constructions today. So in the talk, I will cover three main aspects. So first, why was this commission established? So was a little bit of the prehistory, and I think it links nicely to the case study we just heard. Then I will explain what were actually the objectives and the work of this World Commission on Dams. And to conclude, I will talk about what was the impact of this commission now that we are 20 years after it. What have we actually learned from this initiative? And I want to keep this quite brief to those of you who are working with large dams. None of this will be new, but not everyone here studying these projects. So large dams are very popular for many benefits like hydropower, irrigation, and so on. It's quite easily visible why they would be attractive to governments in many countries, but also large dams are often seen as these symbols of progress, development, often linked to nationalism. So you can see the strength of a nation through the building of these very big infrastructures. A good prominent example is the Akosombo Dam in Ghana. So like many projects planned in the colonial time, but actually completed in the independent country of Ghana. So the president at the time called this Akosombo Dam a place of pilgrimage, a place to go and wonder about the achievements of the new country of Ghana. And just to show the scale, so this is the reservoir that was formed because of the Akosombo Dam. It's more than half the length of the country of Ghana, visible from space. So clearly huge impacts from these infrastructures. And so here are a few books from the 1960s where people became to gain awareness of the ecological impacts that these new infrastructures had. So today this seems obvious to us that large dams have ecological impacts on fish, on ecosystems, but at the time that was new knowledge. For example, here's an edited collection published out of the University of Accra in Ghana from the 1960s. And these books have similar messages, the very first ecological studies on the impacts of dams. Likewise, there was a beginning to be awareness that dams have social impacts beyond just resettling people. So one person who did a lot of research on this was Ted Scudder. He started in the 1950s. He is an anthropologist, and he has worked over 70 years always studying impacts of large dams, nicely summarized in this 2005 book, Future of Large Dams. And one message that he had was dams have an impact from the moment someone proposes them, not from the moment when the planning begins, because people start changing their behavior. Again, we've heard a few examples of this in the session in the morning. So in terms of the scale, in the year 2000, an estimate was made that 40 to 80 million people were displaced by dams, so that's huge numbers. Also, more than half of the world's rivers were affected by dams in the year 2000 already. In the year 2005, this map was created showing in red heavily impacted river systems, in yellow medium impacts, and I'm sure, again, those numbers will have probably gone up with higher percentages of rivers impacted by large dams. Another impact of dams that was not initially taken into account, that people had overlooked, were the downstream impacts of dams. Because upstream, it's very obvious, you create a reservoir, it floods land, you have to move people. But dams also have impacts downstream, often maybe 100 kilometers away, so they were not really taken into account in planning processes. So river fisheries might be one downstream impact where migratory fish can no longer reproduce. So fishermen in the whole river system will be impacted by that. Then floodplain agriculture, cattle grazing that rely on the flood patterns, like a yearly flood pattern or multi-year flood pattern, will be very impacted because suddenly the water comes and goes as the dam owner decides. So that's a huge ecological impact with implications for livelihoods. And this paper, again, it's several hundred million people around the world were affected by these downstream impacts of dams. A book with a specific focus on these impacts in Africa was written by Bill Adams in the 1990s. Again, maybe some of you have seen it, called Wasting the Rain. Describes it quite in nice detail. And then finally, there's also a lot of cultural impacts, quite visible sometimes, where you had to move these historical sites in Egypt. They had to be moved to a new place when dams were built on the River Nile. But there's also intangible heritage that might be affected if certain sacred spaces are no longer available, they are being flooded, and so on. And so one book that was published in the 1990s by an activist, Patrick McCulley, is called Silenced Rivers. It summarized a lot of these very negative impacts from large dams, not just in Africa, also in Asia, in Latin America. And so in the 1990s were really a time where there were a lot of conflicts around large dams between opponents and supporters, and the conflicts were so intense that a lot of projects were delayed. They were also becoming very costly for the dam builders because there were just so many campaigns and so much attention, negative attention to their projects. And so in 1997, the World Bank and IUCN got together to organize a workshop on large dams where they said, well, we have to do something about all these campaigns. We have to find a better way to move out of these conflicts. So they invited a lot of people from different countries around the world. There were several Africans involved as well. So Kalitsi from the Volta River Authority in Ghana, so he was in charge of managing that Akosombo Dam, the authority that manages that electricity. John Briscoe, a South African who was working for the World Bank at the time, he will become important later in the talk, so remember that name. But yeah, there were people from many different stakeholder groups and many different countries. All of them were men, so it was a very gendered activity at the time. Here's just a quick overview of other things that happened in the 1990s that one could say helped leads to this need for a World Commission on Dams to address these conflicts. So two very big dam projects in India and Nepal were abandoned that had received World Bank funding, so that was a huge upset to the World Bank. And there were also very big NGO meetings. Again, Manipeli, this is in India. Another one in Brazil, the Curitiba meeting, where they called for the World Bank to change the policy on large dams. But also, there was an internal review inside the World Bank in 1996, and even that internal review found the World Bank could be doing a lot better in how they manage social and environmental impacts. Yeah, and so the challenge is then, you know about all these negative impacts, and imagine this group of people here in the room, probably a lot of you are social scientists, critical social scientists, political ecologists. I mean, very good at describing the problem, but if you were tasked with solving it, how would you go about it? Or if you were an activist or a displaced person, actually that is the task given to you, right? How do you address these conflicts? I mean, dams do have some benefits. There's no denying of that either. So how can you also stop the making of the East Coast projects or white elephants? That was really the challenge given to this World Commission on Dams. So of course, they phrased it differently. They said, well, we have to review the development effectiveness of these large dams. And also, they had to develop guidelines and criteria, how to build better dams, how to improve the planning process. So it was an extremely ambitious mandate. First of all, understanding everything about large dams globally, and then also making new guidelines that work everywhere in the world. So it was an incredibly broad mandate that they received at this 1997 workshop in Switzerland. I've spoken to some activists who were there in 1997, and they said the proposal for this World Commission on Dams came from them. And they were quite surprised that the World Bank was so supportive. World Bank sources then said this was because of the president at the time, James Wolfensohn, who was very open to working with civil society. So just to summarize very quickly, they were hoping through dialogue, through evidence, we can do something about these many conflicts around large dams. So 12 commissioners were selected to be in the World Commission on Dams. They had a secretariat based in South Africa in Cape Town. And there were also 68 organizations involved as stakeholders who were sort of going to oversee the work. And at the end of this two-year process, they produced a knowledge base. So that is hundreds of reports. It's a really good source, actually, if you need to know about any particular aspect of dams or any particular region in the world, there will be a report in this knowledge base. And also there was one final report which has the recommendations and the synthesis of all this knowledge that was collected over 2 years. So the 12 commissioners, they were under the leadership of a South African first minister of education who then became the minister of water, Kader Asmal. He has already passed away. The vice chair was an Indian social activist. And so we can see, at least in this commission, we had a better gender balance when the workshop was 100% men, at least almost parity here. Also, all the continents were represented, which again, for a global commission at the time, was quite unusual. Like previous commissions, like Brundtland or other commissions, were generally retired men who had would give an objective view on the evidence, whereas these were people who were actually active opposing dams or building dams or overseeing them in government functions. There were also two academics, so Ted Scudder, the one I mentioned earlier, and Brazilian academic who had a much more pro-dam position. So again, I spoke to all of the ones that were still alive at the time of doing research about the history and also what they thought about the developments afterwards. Another aspect of the work of the World Commission on Dams were stakeholder consultation meetings, which they did on all continents. So in Africa, they held it in Cairo. They would invite all the different stakeholder groups, and not just the pro-dam side, but also many people who were affected by dams, people who had been displaced, which again, today it seems quite natural to do, but at the time it was pretty unusual. And also at those meetings, those 12 commissioners that I just showed, they went on field trips where they actually saw the settlements of people that had been displaced. Yeah. And so that was another benefit of those consultation meetings. in principle, this was quite a logical process. So you had all these studies that were commissioned, a knowledge base was created, and then you have recommendations in the final report, which was to be disseminated, and then, you know, you would end all the problems with dams. Of course, I don't want to summarize this entire report. I just want to give you some key messages from it. So one is that the report said there's actually multiple stages in how a dam gets built, and there's key decision points that can be influenced through research or through meeting with people. And one key insight here was there's the dam option, but also there's the non-dam option. And you have to think, what is actually my development objective? And if it can be met through a non-dam option, as they call it, why not go with the non-dam option rather than building this expensive large dam? They also had 7 very high-level strategic priorities. I don't want to go into detail, but they addressed a lot of the social and environmental impacts of large dams that I mentioned in the first part. And in general, I mean, this was a mix of policy goals, a mix of methods. It was quite a holistic report that really tried to cover any aspect that you can think of on large dams. A common theme was that you have to avoid or reduce these negative impacts wherever possible. Again, quite logical. You have to start planning early on, think about alternatives very early on. And what they called, in terms of the conceptual framework, they called it the rights and risks approach, which very interestingly, multiple people that I interviewed said it was their idea, and I don't know who actually had the idea. I think most likely hypothesis the chair, because he was a lawyer as well. So talking about rights of people who were affected or risks of people who might be at risk from a large dam, all of these people should be involved in the planning. That is what the commission recommended, including giving this free, prior, and informed consent to indigenous peoples who would be affected. Again, quite unusual at the time, nowadays a lot more accepted. And so the idea was all the people who lose out from these large projects should become beneficiaries of them, linking also to the question we just heard on the previous presentation. And so this report was launched in a very high-profile event in London. Nelson Mandela was there, the global press was there. The chair, Kader Asmal, he said, well, this is a wedding of the opponents and the supporters of dams, and it's a wake because the commission dissolved itself, so it didn't continue to exist, which again is an unusual thing. A lot of commissions, they go on for a very long time. And he said, well, what happens next is up to you. So there was this anticipation, this report will really change how dams are being built. There was a lot of hope and expectation that this would make a difference. And so in the third part, I just want to very briefly touch upon some of the things that happened after the launch of this final report. And so one obvious thing you would expect, well, how did industry react? Because industry would need to implement these very progressive standards of turning losers into beneficiaries, of reducing all the negative impacts. And so immediately after the launch, 3 industry associations, so Irrigation, International Commission on Large Dams, Hydropower Association, they published a joint letter, the first and only time they did that, to say, we reject all the guidelines, we agree that they are too negative. You have overlooked the benefits of large dams, and what you propose is not realistic, will mean we cannot build any more large dams if you always involve the people who are affected and so on. Again, the World Bank was a key target of that report because they had funded part of the process. So the hope of the commission was the World Bank will change their policies. But the World Bank had a mixed reaction. They said, well, we think this is a good initiative. We support it in principle, but we will also not adopt the guidelines. And so that is, of course, a bit surprising, thinking they have funded this process. Why did they not support the outcome of the process? And so, of course, that is something I asked in interviews to people who were involved in the World Commission on Dams, and one person put it like this. They said, well, there were key people inside the World Bank who thought this was not in our interest. But really, they're all talking about this one person, John Briscoe, so the senior water advisor, who had been there at the workshop in 1997. And I think the reason why the World Commission on Dams was hosted in South Africa is because he was very influential in the World Bank. He thought, well, this would be a good country to have this commission. But he was very much in favor of large dams. He thought after 2 years, there will be a report saying, well, there's some minor problems, but we can solve them and more dams will be built. And to his surprise, the report was very critical of large dams. And so he felt almost personally offended. He went to the Chinese government, the Indian government, Ethiopian government, and said, well, there's this report, but please ignore it, say that you don't agree with it. And I've interviewed a lot of people, and that was a consistent message I got from others. So this one put it much less politely. So he said, well, John Briscoe misrepresented our work. He distorted what we said. He misled people about it. And so for me, that was, again, really surprising. I quite naively thought the World Bank is a big organization. One individual person will not be so influential. But this was a very consistent pattern over many interviews where they said, well, the senior water advisor didn't like it, so the World Bank ended up not supporting it. And thinking about the more recent past, so maybe the last 5 years, there's some mixed response from industry. So this association that initially opposed it completely, they developed a sustainability assessment protocol where they take up some of the recommendations, some tools to translate them into practice. Of course, this is an industry initiative, so you have to be critical of it. But at least there is some awareness that even industry cannot ignore the negative impacts of large dams. The second aspect I wanted to focus on in terms of impacts and legacies, so there were a lot of personal impacts of this initiative. So this was the engineer on the commission, had spent 50 years building large dams all around the world. And someone said about him when, for the first time, he visited displaced people, he actually came back crying. He had never understood that large dams don't help people. He had always thought they help people. And so one reason why this commission was so critical, because the industry representatives generally learned through the process, through that personal exposure to displaced people. Others have said he was not very experienced with politics, so he should have been more careful in what he signed off. He was actually disowned by his own association afterwards in supporting this report. But again, it was quite interesting finding from the research how pro-dam people were really changed their minds through this experience of visiting displaced people and learning about all the negative impacts. Another impact is that I think these multi-stakeholder dialogue processes, they became legitimized through World Commission on Dams, of course, a lot of other initiatives as well. At the time, people emphasized very much, well, we have all the evidence shows large dams are problematic. But really, when they talk about evidence, they're not talking about numbers. So it was not a very quantitative scientific approach of collecting evidence. It was an approach of collecting evidence through testimonies, through speaking to people. The evidence is irrefutable, ground truth. But so engaging the stakeholders became much, much more common today. And the last aspect in terms of legacies and impacts, I think today the situation is again very different. At the time, year 2000, you could lobby the World Bank and say, well, we have changed things. Of course, they did not manage that. But today, dam financing is very fragmented. You have a lot of private investment in dams. You don't really know who is funding dams. There's new countries that got involved, China, India, who built a lot inside their country, a lot in other countries. The Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam has a lot of Ethiopian funding and so on. So it's not so simple anymore to have a global commission and make recommendation. Today the picture is a lot more complex. And also I would argue the 1990s were that rare time where everyone was quite hopeful and optimistic. So the Cold War had just ended. War on terrorism hadn't yet started. Apartheid had just ended in South Africa. This was based in South Africa. So there was really this momentum to think, well, we can actually have an impact. And I think today we're not really in that anymore. If you would like to read more, there's a few publications. I'm also still working on some. So this was a literature review about the impacts of this commission, then a paper on the history published in Water History, giving you more detail on what I've just presented. And then one that just came out on the politics inside this commission. How did they actually come to an agreement between the two sides?
Okay, yeah, thank you.